His depth of intel is undefeated, and we are blessed to have you on Catch This Fade. And we would love to have you back again post draft so we can talk about what the Cowboys did or did not do, what you would have liked to seen them do, and just have another good talk, man.
Well, I tell you what, it's a lot easier talking about it afterwards than it is before.
Isn't it?
So, yeah.
Amen. Right? Now, that's science.
There might be some curse words involved. So, you know, you guys might be paying for some curse words here in the end.
And I get it. You got a bunch of talent, but also keeping in mind that not every person drafted in the first round will be a Pro Bowler. That's just not how this works. Now, that being said, let me hop over to the soapbox that says you should also not draft purely out of need, because then that inserts and injects a sense of desperation into your decision. And for any well-functioning adult, you know that the worst decisions you've ever made in your life were fueled by desperation.
And he's the bully, whereas the other guys are more finesse route running speed.
Right.
He is the bully in that group. But what I would much rather have is the guy that absolutely forces you to double team every single time, because you have to keep a safety 20 yards down the field because that guy has so much speed. So in that vein, I want the Cowboys to draft somebody now so that they can take over as wide receiver 3 when you're running Cooper and Lamb, and then have a speedster. And if that comes with Kyle Pitts or whatever the case may be, that's even more of a bonus. But even without that, I need a speedster in the mix. I have to have a speedster in the mix. All right. You are now rocking with the best, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for tuning in to another exciting, exhilarating episode of the Catch This Fade podcast. I am, of course, your host, KD Drummond. That is my man, 5 grand, the one and only Mr. Patrick No C Star.
No C Star. Somebody been watching SpongeBob. What is going on?
Run it back. Three. I promise
we keeping all this too for this
for the free roll. The free roll gets everything.
We're gonna get everything. Oh, we keeping all this.
Take 3.
Yes, sir.
I'm gonna have to talk to Skywalker about this one.
Nope. Let it flow.
All right. You are now rocking with the best, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for tuning in to another exciting, exhilarating episode of the Catch This Fade podcast. I am, of course, your host, KD Drummond. That is my man, 5 grand, Mr. Patrick No C Walker. Say what's up to the people, Pat.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome back. This is, I think, the third take of KD trying to get this right. But if you are a friend of the program, then you got pre-rolled in. You caught all of it. So make sure, if you are not a friend of the program, as far as the subscription tiers go, become one, because you are missing out on a lot of greatness that happens before we go live. Shenanigans,
tomfoolery,
chicanery, tomfoolery, all of the above happens. So welcome back. We have a very special episode today. We are not going to reveal who our guest is just yet, but we do have an incomparable guest coming up in the next 20 minutes or so.
Yep.
But before we get into our special guest, Katie and myself, we're going to go ahead and do what we normally do, which is get this elite fun kicked off, talking about the Cowboys. We're going to do some play the percentages. We're going to start, you know, digging a little bit into this draft talk, hint at who the guest might be. And then we'll kind of go from there, now that we have Katie and his system issues all worked out.
Okay, yeah. So first of all, you tried it. Anybody that has a pre-roll knows that your bump system is the reason why we're even delayed and had to shrink everything else. But we'll go ahead and start talking about the Cowboys right now, because the draft is approaching. The Cowboys have basically gotten to a lull as far as the NFL in general. You get onesie twosies here, but in general, free agency has died down, and now everybody's focus is really on the NFL draft, which is coming up at the end of the month. So where does that leave the Cowboys? They are in a position where they still have filled their needs somewhat, but to my estimation, they haven't done a good enough job, and they still have left themselves exposed, needing the draft to come through with him at certain positions when it comes to how things are going to play out. So all the talk now is about the draft, how they're going to do what they normally do, whether they'll move around in the first round, get additional picks, possibly trade up. Please don't trade up. I hate the fact that anybody's talking about trading up.
It's exclamation just point. Do let the not other team do it.
Let the other teams make that mistake and spend that capital in order to come up. Just let the draft fall to you. And if an opportunity for you to trade back comes around, then I want you to do that. But more importantly, the Cowboys have to have a firm strategy for how they are going to evaluate talent. Last year, CeeDee Lamb fell to them. They didn't have really any other choice but to make the right decision and draft a player who some people thought was at a position that they didn't need, but in reality, you do need a third wide receiver.
It was still a position of need. Yep, Randall Cobb was leaving. You had, you know, a year removed from losing Cole Beasley. It was a position of need.
Yep, exactly. So I have recently talked about what my philosophy is for talent acquisition through the draft. On one side of the argument, you have people that say, grab the best player available no matter what. Doesn't matter what position it is. Doesn't matter what you have in the cupboard. If the cupboard isn't bare, I don't care. Take the best player available. That's how you move. That's how you build a pertinent roster. There are other people that believe that the way to function is to go out and fill your biggest needs. If your biggest need is quarterback, clearly you're going to take a quarterback if one is available for you. But let's say that your biggest need is a nose tackle or a defensive tackle at 3-tech. If that guy isn't the best player available at the draft, does it make sense to do that? My philosophy that you marry the two, and I've been using this phrase for over a decade, is called BPAPN, best player available at a position of need, which basically means that you marry the two. You take your groups of positions that you really desperately need help in, and then you take the best player available among those positions. Right. So you don't focus only on one thing. You say, okay, well, there's two or three positions that we really need. Let's take the best player there, and then we worry about the rest of it later. So you're still taking the best player available, just making sure that he does fit into your game plan and he can be an immediate contributor, especially when it comes to your first round pick. That first round pick has to contribute. We can't have another Taco Charlton. It has to contribute, right, Pat?
Yeah, it has to be a day one contributor, not someone ideally, not someone that requires a year of development or anything like that. It has to be, especially when you're picking in the top 10. We're not just talking about first round in general, wherein, you know, 25 to 32 is technically the beginning of the second round. We're talking about a top 10 pick. You better nail this pick to the wall. He has to come in. He has to start from day one, and he has to make an impact in doing so. So I'm completely with you on the BPAPM, because what I don't appreciate and what I can't find tolerance for are takes that swing the pendulum either too far to the left or too far to the right. So you have those that say, well, it doesn't matter what your need is whatsoever. 100% of the time you go for the best player available. No, you do not. Because what you're going to end up then is a situation where your team is completely lopsided, right? Or just completely out of sorts. You don't really have a plan. You don't have a game plan. You're just kind of going in. You might as well just scrap your board for the most part and just say, hey, we're just going to constantly pick pure BPA. And then 4 or 5 years down the road, you look back on a half decade's worth of drafts. What really have you pieced together? And I get it. You got a bunch of talent, but also keeping in mind that not every person drafted in the first round will be a Pro Bowler. That's just not how this works. Now, that being said, let me hop over to the soapbox that says you should also not draft purely out of need, because then that inserts and injects a sense of desperation into your decision. And for any well-functioning adult, you know that the worst decisions you've ever made in your life were fueled by desperation more often than not. So what you do is, and I'm glad you brought this up, what you do
that
is with the Cowboys...
That one night stand that ended up in the kitchen.
Desperation. Listen, why were you at the bar in the first place? Desperation. Right? Now, we're not talking about, you know, for the most part, we're not necessarily talking about folks in their, you know, 40s and 50s. I mean, I'm 40. Katie's in his 40s. Sometimes you might go to the bar because you just need some air. You might want to throw back a couple. That's fine. A
little bit of socialization.
But let's not be naive and say that in your 20s, you were going to the bar simply because you wanted to throw back a couple. No, you were
trying to cut something.
Yeah, you were out to
get something. You were out to get
something. So cut the shit. I get it. but you, what I love what the Cowboys have done, at least for the most part, and I'll touch base on what I feel like they've kind of dropped the ball on. But for the most part, you go out and you address the safety position, something that you and I talked about in great detail after the signing of Keanu Neal, DeMonte Kazee. And you and I are in agreement that although they did address that, we still need to see them take an impact player at the position to really solidify what they've told Dan Quinn, which is, hey, we're going to value the safety position. So let's see. But even, you know, that notwithstanding, Neal, Kazee, you got Wilson, you're in a much better safety position on at least on paper than you were even a few months ago. I really like the signing of Brent Urban. I think he can be a dynamic run stopper. He graded out as one as recently as last season. Yes, but he still needs help. So you're going to have to address that. And I did in my one and only mock on CBS Sports. Shameless plug. Go check that out. I'm still looking at the cornerback position. You know, I want – obviously, I'm Surtain Hive. That's 1A. Horn right. is 1B for me. And I, no matter what they do at the position – from a free agency standpoint, I still want them to go and get one of those guys in the first round. But I don't think they've addressed it in the way that they've addressed the safety position, in that you brought in Kazee and you brought in Neil, albeit as a flex.
And Curse.
And Jerron Curse.
Right.
Because you want that insurance. Where's your insurance at cornerback opposite Trevon Diggs?
You don't know what you're getting
with Maurice Kennedy and his return from opting out last season. You know, there are rumors, and I'm hearing that the Cowboys are considering dropping Reggie Robinson back down. Round of applause for that. However,
yeah, that's kind of been mixed signals.
We'll see how it plays out, because on one aspect, I've had a couple of conversations where they're like, yeah, they're going to do it. And I've had a couple of conversations where I've heard that, you know, where they're still thinking about it. So
you know what that means
on the
to
side
me?
Of caution. It means that they're still thinking about it.
No, you know what that means to me? Is that they're still undecided, which means that he's not an integral part of their plans. Because if he was an integral part of their plans, they would have been like, he's definitely staying at safety. He's definitely moving.
And I agree.
Let's see what he does in training camp, and then maybe we'll decide if he's important or not.
Right. So adding to that point, even if they were fully committed to him being a key part right now, as we have this conversation, you don't have any game film on him. You have no NFL game film on him. So you can't. Theirs.
Mike Nolan. Have to let it go. I'll never get a show.
Nolan, Linguist, you know.
All of them. All them.
All them. Your cousin them. Right.
Them dudes.
Right. They forgot about Lil Brun them. Never forget about Lil Brun them.
Let's do this. we know. I mean, we don't have to rehash it, you know, all the time. But we know that cornerback is going to be the biggest need for the Cowboys. Absolutely. And right now it lines up that there should be very good quality, high quality talent at the number 10 pick at that position. So the needs seem to marry
talent,
because what we're looking at right now, is the fact that the Cowboys have the number 10 pick. They could trade back. They could do a bunch of things, but we're actually at the point now. Let's interrupt our play the percentages. Before we do that, let's kick our play the percentages to the end of the show. Right. Let's go ahead and welcome in our esteemed guest that is going to be joining us for this show.
Yes.
It is going to be an exciting... This is really our first guest. I've had a guest host when you were on vacation, but this is going to be our first official guest on Catch This Fade on the Patreon platform.
And it's a whale.
So let's go ahead and kick that off now. There he is, the one and only Mr. Brian Broaddus. How are you, sir?
He's in the building.
I am doing great, boys. Anytime the Texas Rangers play and I can get off the air early, I'm all for it.
Listen, the Ranger
team, like all I ever see on my damn timeline is Atlanta Brave.
Listen, we are not going to do that today, Brian Broaddus. No.
They broke out my old Dale Murphy uniforms the other day, the Biff Pope.
And you loved it. And we were cooking with them. And now, you know, I don't know, we've cooled down. Well, we're not going to give KD an avenue to throw shade at my Braves.
I mean,
we're
not going to do it. Nothing. Did y'all win today? Yeah. Have y'all won today?
Well, we haven't played today.
You haven't won yet today. I'm the Nationals.
He's the Nationals. And he's in the last place in the division. We beat them too. We took the series and your last place in the division.
We have a COVID mulligan right now, my guy. But back to what Brian said, the Texas Rangers cheat me out of my spot, because I'm on with the nosebleeds on Tuesdays, and now every week I'm getting bumped because the Rangers are playing on 105.3 The Fan. So I can't even do my
totally
spot
fine. Anymore. I think that's totally fine.
I'll tell you what I like about the nosebleeds. They've given a lot of guys opportunities and gals a lot of opportunities. You guys all work so hard at what you do. And, you know, people, you guys get those times to come on those, you know, for 12, 14 minutes. You guys did a hell of a job. I mean, you know, I know driving around a lot at night, I listen to you guys, and I'm not just saying it because I'm your friend, but seriously, I told those guys, I said, listen, that's great. You give guys, Bobby Corella was a guy they gave, you know, from the Mavs. I mean, he knows a lot. I mean, I see Bobby at Mavs games. I'm like, bro, you know more Mavs basketball than anybody, but I'm glad that they gave guys like yourself a shot to be on the radio at night. I think that's I think it's a good way of doing things. I really do.
It's very much appreciated. That platform, you know, on the home of the Cowboys is very much appreciated. But what I'm most thankful for is that
too.
They do. Yeah. But what I'm most thankful for is the fact that you're now a full-time member and we get to listen to you on a regular basis.
Absolutely.
As opposed to the shows that we had before.
Bro, let me tell you what, man. I was talking to Derek Eagleton about this the other day. I used to spend 14 hours a day worrying about this football team. And now I have to watch the Mavs. I haven't missed a Mavs game in all year. I mean, I haven't missed a Mavs game. I missed a Rangers game. I missed a Stars game. That's what happens to you. Is like when you go away from working like where I was with the Cowboys and having to talk about all the other sports, you can't get exposed. And so you got to watch the damn games. And my coverage of the Cowboys, I used to do 300 draft profiles a year.
Yep. One of the best parts of my offseason was reading those.
Right now. That's all I can do. I can't because I got, you know, there's only so much time of the day. So
yeah, but your quality hasn't taken a hit whatsoever. So whether you're doing 300, 160, or 125, sir, you are still very much cooking in the kitchen.
That's the thing that when you get down to it, and you know, Bobby Belt's done a great job of helping with tape and stuff like that. And
it's our guy, Bobby.
Yeah. So, I mean, if I didn't have that, I wouldn't be able to cover the draft. I mean, you can't always, there's some things that you can get off YouTube. If you get a defensive back where they keep feeding the ball at him and stuff and get an idea of how he's playing. But overall, you didn't have that tape. The minute they take all that tape away from me, I'm out. I'm cooking crawfish. I'm going to the lake.
Gotta have your crawfish. Your race car team. Yeah.
Go find somebody else to talk to on a Wednesday night. You ain't talking to my ass.
Well, we got you right now, so I definitely want to dive into some of the conversation, and obviously the listeners, to us, you're famous. Occasionally, we might have somebody else that is unfamiliar with your importance. You used to work for the Cowboys, clearly, during the Bill Parcells years. You've been covering the team for a long time, so you're as in tune with this team and the way that they function as anybody, which is why we wanted you to honestly be our first guest that we had on the show as we roll out our in-depth draft coverage. So Pat and I just wanted to basically just talk to you in general about where the Cowboys stand right now. So one of the topics that we were talking about before you came on was the strategy that the team employs in how they build their board and how they attack the draft. So I brought up the point that I believe in BPAPN, which is best player available at a position of need, as opposed to just being pure BPA or just going pure by need. So I wanted to kind of get your insight on how you see the best strategy and how you think the Cowboys approach the draft and how they build their board and what they look for on draft night and on draft weekend.
Yeah. That's, I think to me, one of the things that you know, it's funny. We had Tom Siskalski on today, and Tom and I, when I first started with the Cowboys had like 300 and something names on their board. I mean, it was crazy. I came from Green Bay and I showed Larry Lacewell my board from Green Bay. It had like 148 names on it. You know, every year, that's with the scouts, with the John Dorseys and the John Snyders and Scott McLuhan's. I mean, we had a lot of really good scouts, but we didn't, our board was so small because it's like, listen, let's don't window dress this thing. If we don't like this guy, let's not put him on there and stuff. And then it got to the point where Lacewell says, well, don't you run out of names? And I'm like, no, every draft we would have six names left on that board. Every single time, six names. And we were thinking, oh, that was pretty cool. So, you know, over the years, I mean, Will McClay has taken it, you know, these guys, the Cowboys have taken, they don't have a lot of turnover in their scouting department, but Will has been at some other places. And so that, you know, when the way they build their boards is they do it by position, by round. So you have all the wide receivers from rounds 1 through 7 there. And that's how they got it. But, you know, with Parcells too, there, it was one of those things we were like, man, you got those things stacked in there like club sandwiches. And I'm like, no, that's not the way it needs to be. You need to shrink that board as much as you can. And I think Will has done a much better job of that. The less clutter you have with those names. And like I said, don't window dress the board. If you don't want to take a guy at that spot, don't just stick him up there because, you know, you heard in the media that, oh, this guy's a player and all that. Hell no. Right. Evaluate the player and put him where you would take him. And that's why some of the picks that they made, like the Jalen Smith one and stuff like that, it's like, to them, they didn't window dress their board. They stuck that guy where they were going to take him. And I think that's – and the CeeDee Lamb pick last year is a great example. There's no way in hell that I thought that they were going to take CeeDee Lamb there. No way in hell I thought they were going to do it. But they did, because they said, you know, hey, we have this guy graded right there. The stack tells us who the guy is. And they took the first player on their stack that was left. And I applaud him for that. And that gives me hope going forward that if you're a Cowboy fan, they're just not going to draft need. They could take the best player on their board. And I think that's a good, a great way to draft.
Now, that brings up, that gives me a good segue to my next question for you, Brian, which is, you mentioned CeeDee Lamb and you mentioned the fact that obviously, I mean, he was BPA, but there was still an aspect of need from that because you lost Randall Cobb in free agency. You were a year removed from losing Cole Beasley in free agency. So there was still an aspect of need, which kind of goes back to KD's BPA, PN formula. For a second consecutive year, though, now you're hearing, now Kyle Pitts is the name. And you're hearing that the Cowboys are, quote unquote, infatuated with him. And as I've stated often, 32 teams are infatuated with Kyle Pitts. Right. That's just how it goes. Now, of course, 1, 2, 3, that's going to be QB, QB, QB. The draft doesn't really start until number 4. I, for one, think that the Falcons, I think that they are interested in someone like Kyle Pitts if they are truly in on keeping Matt Ryan and not necessarily starting to put one of his feet out of the door. But from a Cowboy standpoint, if for whatever unfathomable reason, Kyle Pitts is still there at number 10, do you think it's a CeeDee Lamb type situation where Pitts potentially still being on the board at the same time as Surtain, maybe Horn is still there as well? You got Rashawn Slater. We'll see where, you know, Slater goes first or Sewell goes first, because you got the Bengals on the clock as well before the Cowboys. But all said, if Kyle Pitts is there, do you see another CeeDee Lamb situation?
Man, that's a great question, because but to me, I don't think Kyle Pitts is going to be there. I know in my mind I'm not planning on him being there. There's too many teams. I've got friends in Atlanta that I've talked to, and I'm like, hey, you're going to stay there? You're going to move? And it's like, they're telling me they're open for business. If somebody makes them a decent offer to come and get their pick, and I don't think Atlanta is going to come flying out of there, you know, down to 15 or 20. I don't, unless somebody like Washington comes up and just offers them this massive deal to take that pick. But I think that Atlanta wants to stand in there and make a pick. I think that, you know, another team you have to think about is, the Dolphins at 6.
Yes, yes, yes.
I mean, there's so many teams. You could put Pitts with every single team in the top 10, and it would be fine. So in my heart of hearts, I'm not planning on it being there. If, in fact, the draft gods give you a gift and he's there, I think it would be really hard for the Cowboys not to take him now. But I do feel like, though, that it's, to me, it's Pitts is the only player I think could sway him that way to offense. Yep. I think a tackle could, but if you're saying a tackle's on the board or Surtain's on that board, I think they're going to take the Surtain pick over the tackle. Okay. Even though there's people in the organization that will say, you know what, are we going to have Tyron Smith for 13 games, for 12 games, for 10 games? There's people that believe that with Tyron Smith's situation, and, you know, even to Lyle Collins, that if you take one of those offensive tackles, and they have a great history of taking offensive linemen and plugging them in and those guys immediately playing.
Yeah.
So there's some value to that to them. And, you know, as much as I know that Jerry Jones covets the front of that pocket, you know, and Dak Prescott's health, you know, moving, you know,
big point right there
in the guard, yeah, that's a possibility. But I don't plan on Pitts being there. I will say, if he is there, I think it would be really, really hard for them not to take him. But if it comes down to one of those offensive tackles or Surtain, I think they'll take Surtain.
Perfect. Yeah, that's pretty much how I feel about it. And Pat argues with me all the time, but it's beautiful.
I believe Pitts is long gone before the Cowboys go on the clock, and the Cowboys absolutely cannot trade up to chase offense with a defense that looks like this.
Absolutely not. They can't give up multiple picks. They have to take advantage of having this.
Sit tight and let the draft come to you.
I'll say this, though, boys. If they do trade up, I'd like to see him take 44 and 75 and try and get this thing back up in the bottom of the first. Now, if they do take an offensive tackle at 10 and you could get back in the health is good on Farley
now we're talking. One of those guys,
I think Newsom is probably the third corner off the board. And I know for a fact that the Cowboys, they love Horn. They do love Horn. I mean, but but that's a fight. I mean, Dan Quinn's best friend, was the head coach at South Carolina, was Will Muschamp.
They're
going to know everything about Horn there is to know. And I think it's going to be Surtain, but I'll be interested to hear and see where that board, where those scouts have Surtain and Horn, could be those tags are touching that way. We'll see.
All right. I want to dive into a little bit more about your draft takes and who you like in the draft, but I'm going to have to disappoint some of our listeners and some of our viewers because this is the end of our free show. If you want more of this greatness from Brian Broaddus and the rest of our show, you're going to have to subscribe on patreon.com/catchthisfade. So if you're already a subscriber at the $3 tier, the $10 tier, or the annual tier, you will get more of this greatness from the one and only Brian Broaddus. If not, go sign up now and transfer over.